Good afternoon. Excellent. My name is Jessica Thomas, and I am Director of Strategic Initiatives here at the Council on Foreign Relations, and I'm also our Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Business Partner. In addition to that, I'm a very proud 2017 Fellow of the International Career Advancement Program, ICAP, and so pleased to have each of you here for the 10th Annual Conference on Diversity in International Affairs. We're here in person, something to celebrate. It's very exciting. A few reminders before we kick off today's plenary. This meeting is on the record, and we have attendees who are joining both in person and also obviously here, in person and also virtually. For everyone who's attending virtually, you may ask a question during the question and answer period by clicking on the raise hand function on your Zoom window. When you're called on to speak, please accept the unmute now prompt and you'll be called on. Please proceed with your name, your affiliation, followed by your question. Your video will remain off, but your microphone will be unmuted. For everyone here in person, I remind you to please silence your mobile devices. When you're called on to speak during the question and answer period, please stand. Make sure to speak into the microphone, state your name and affiliation before asking your question. And now, I will introduce to you my colleague, Jim Lindsay, who is CFR's Senior Vice President and Director of Studies. Jim.
Let me join Jessica in welcoming all of you here today, all of you who are here in person, as well as joining us via the internet. As Jessica mentioned, I'm Jim Lindsay, Senior Vice President here at the Council. It is my great pleasure to welcome you here to the second day of the Conference on Diversity and International Affairs here at the Council on Foreign Relations. As Council President Richard Haass mentioned at yesterday's opening session, the Council is committed to helping pave the way for the next generation of foreign policy professionals. Now, we hold the Conference on Diversity and International Affairs every year as part of that commitment. We strive to bring together speakers and participants from a wide range of backgrounds in groups that are historically underrepresented in the field of foreign policy. The goal of the conference is to increase the access and preparedness for a career in foreign policy. Now, we're very fortunate that two outstanding organizations that share the Council's commitment to creating a more diversified foreign policy community have collaborated with us on this conference. They are the Global Access Pipeline, GAP, and the International Career Advancement Program, ICAP. For those of you who are unfamiliar with GAP, it is a collaborative network of organizations forming a pipeline for underrepresented groups in the United States from elementary school through senior leadership positions. ICAP is a professional development leadership program for high-promising mid-career professionals in international affairs in the United States. On behalf of Richard Haass, I want to thank the CAP and ICAP leadership teams for their work with the Council on the annual Conference on Diversity and International Affairs and on their broader work in the area. And I want to specifically single out Florence Akinyemi, Wida Amir, Nima Patel Edwards, Gabrielle Gay, Lily Lopez McGee, Lana Shantz, and Alyssa Tafti. Now, if I get a round of applause for those people, I would really appreciate it. All of us also owe a very big thank you to Tom Rowe, who oversees both GAP and ICAP. Tom has been a leading voice in the field for more years than he would want me to tell you. So I just simply want to ask you also if we could have some applause for Tom. It would be remiss of me not to thank my colleagues here at the Council who have worked countless hours pulling together this year's conference. Being both virtual and in person creates a unique set of challenges, and people have been working very hard to overcome them. And I especially want to single out Tegan Judd, Connor Sutherland, Megan Studer and Shira Swartz. So if I get a round of applause for them as well, I would appreciate it. I want to remind everybody that after today's panel, we will host a reception both in person and on Zoom. I hope that you can stay to meet one another online and to continue the conversation. At this point, I'm now going to turn the microphone over to the presider for this afternoon's of discussion. That's Arshad Mohammed. Arshad is a diplomatic correspondent for Reuters. In his career as a journalist, he has covered the White House and the State Department, and he has reported from New York, Paris, Algiers, and of course from here in Washington, D.C. My thanks to Arshad and to our panelists for being here today. Over to you, Arshad.
Thank you, Jim. My name's Arshad Mohammed. I'm a reporter with Reuters. Thank you all for being here. Welcome to today's 2022 Conference on Diversity in International Affairs Plenary 2. This session is entitled U.S. Democracy, by the People, for the People. I'm very pleased to have some really interesting panelists, starting at my far left, Art Motta, who is the National Director of Policy and Legislation of the League of United Latin American Citizens, or LULAC. Next to me is Ashley Quarcoo, who's a Senior Director with Democracy Programs and Pillars at the Partnership for American Democracy. She's also a non-resident scholar at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. Virtually, we're joined by Minh-Thu Pham, who is co-founder of New American Voices and who, like Ashley, is a former CFR term member. Essentially, what we're here to talk about is the health of American democracy. And I'd like to start by asking each of you, perhaps starting with you, Art, what you think is the current state of American democracy, what are the symptoms of its health or sickness?
Thank you for the question. Nice looking crowd here. Good, thank you all for being here on day two of your events here. It's good to be back in person. Sorry you're in the box today, but we'll talk to you soon. I'm at the League of United Latin American Citizens. Our organization is celebrating 93 years since our founding. 93 years. And when you think about why our organization was founded, we are the oldest and largest Latino and Hispanic membership volunteer-based organization in the country. We have over 1,000 active chapters and councils across the country. This week, one of our councils in Uvalde, Texas, has been working nonstop since Tuesday to help the families and the community in Uvalde, Texas there. Just yesterday, our team was at the White House with President Biden when he was signing an executive order on policing and criminal justice, which we helped draft with his team. And when we think about the health of our democracy, you know, for LULAC, we see our members, our volunteers, as the heart of our organization. When you think about the health of any organization, any democracy, you definitely need to find out and ask yourself, where is the heart of the organization? Where is the heart of the country? Who is leading? Who is guiding that country? We've seen our own country in the last few years face turmoil within our population, within our citizens, residents, the type of language that was used to disrupt our day-to-day living. For us, we see ourselves as, our home is America. We see ourselves as Americans, as citizens. Folks have left their home countries in Latin America to come to the U.S. because of that vision, that ideal that the American dream is for everyone, and you can't accomplish that. We're seeing the turmoil in Latin American countries to this day. But America is our home. We know that there are promises that America has kept for our ancestors, and we are committed to making sure that this democracy remains healthy. There are times when it's not so healthy, but looking at, you were asking about the symptoms that we see. Again, our leadership, who is leading the country, our democracy, if we call it that, if we can call it that, I should say. There's times where we're not so sure what to call it. But knowing that organizations like ours do have to work with the leadership of not only our country, our administration, but even in our states across the country, you know, what is the health of democracies in our states? Our membership, you know, ideology-wise, do vary across the political spectrum. We have members that are, you know, hardcore Roman Catholics and conservative, and then we have folks on the other side of the spectrum that think that AOC is a moderate and not progressive enough. So we have to deal with that on a day-to-day. I'll stop there.
Forgive me for cutting in, Art, but in two words, would you say the democracy is now healthy or unhealthy?
It gets better. we hope. We have to hope it gets better. So.
Ashley, if I may turn to you next. Same question. Is the democracy healthy, and what are its symptoms?
I would not describe us as healthy. I would describe us as, you know, I don't know, having a bad cold or some other description. I remain an optimist, but I spent most of my career working on democracy globally, and so I have always looked at the United States in comparative perspective from that experience. And I look at sort of you know, key indicators. Certainly, if you look at any kind of global comparison of the U.S. vis-a-vis other democracies, we're in decline and have been in decline relative to ourselves and relative to the rest of the world. We have been through a lot of turmoil, but I think that the aftermath of especially a lot of the events of 2020 have not really, we're yet to see the impact of those on our democracy, and I'll talk about a couple of things in particular. One is lots of attention has been put on the new legislation that has been restrictive of voting rights in a lot of parts of the country. I think that's one important indicator, of course, to assess the health of our democracy. But I think another important indicator is that we are seeing increasing efforts to make even just the administration of elections themselves become much more partisan, or much more the control of those processes to become much more partisan. So several laws that have been introduced and passed in certain places that will put the election process in the control of people with partisan agendas. We've seen laws that are going to criminalize election officials for making, you know, there will be mistakes in any kinds of election, but the kind of chilling effect that kind of legislation has on really just public servants doing their duty. We've seen those officials being suffered from harassment, threats, intimidation. They're being driven out of their jobs. They're being, threatened. Their families are being threatened. So we do have a sort of a crisis in the sense of the atrophy of our election, of the administration of our elections, and I think that is an untold story and really, really important as we consider the health of our democracy. Another really quick thing I'll say is an indicator we'd look at overseas is freedom of speech, and I will say I look at the issue around book banning as a freedom of speech issue. I think it is, again, an under kind of examined part of kind of what we look at the health of our democracy. But there are, you know, over 1,500 books that have been banned across, you know, like 86 counties and 25 states. So half the country, this kind of censorship is happening. And that is that's a chilling kind of dynamic. And if I was looking at this country overseas, I would be alarmed by that kind of censorship, especially because it's being done in response to directives of elected officials in the state, not because of community members lifting up these concerns and wanting to address them. I'll leave it there then.
Thank you. Minh-Thu, what's your take on health or illness?
Thanks so much, and really great to be here. I'm sorry I can't be down there in Washington today with you all. So just to add to some of the great things that have already been said, first is just to reiterate Ashley's point. On the censorship and freedom of speech, I think we also need to be looking at the health of our independent media and journalism in this country. I think we know the stories. There's been a backsliding, or at least a decline in local journalism, which, you know, it's really important for communities to have reliable, fact-based sources of information. And I think disinformation, misinformation has taken hold in a lot of places. And that's quite concerning. Secondly, just to Ashley's point about voting rights, I think we also need to look at passive voter suppression. So when we look at our democracy, the sense of belonging that people have, and whether this is truly an egalitarian democracy is an issue. I think, you know, the kinds of things that we saw with George Floyd's murder 2 years ago really brought a lot of that to the fore, where many Americans don't feel like they participate and can belong in our democracy. And, you know, a lot of campaigns during elections don't even reach out to a whole swath of Americans. You know, the poor, immigrants, overlooked, marginalized communities of color aren't often the targets of campaign outreach. And as a result, the effect of their not turning out to vote because they're not reached by campaigns actually has been shown to be even greater than active voter suppression legislation that's taking hold across the country right now. The third thing I'd want to raise is just civic engagement. And actually, I think on there, we're doing a whole lot better. I was going to start this by saying, you know, if I could check a page from Richard Haass's book of grading, you know, foreign policy or grading performance, I'd say our democracy, I'd give it a C minus. And you know, I think we all know the negatives, January 6th, the sort of rise of disinformation and authoritarianism and that sort of thing. But I think on the sort of healthier side of that equation is civic engagement. You know, since the election of Donald Trump, but actually even before that, I think we've seen an increase in many Americans deciding to march, deciding to turn out to vote. I mean, the 2020 election, the voter outreach and turnout was just phenomenal. Within the Asian American community, it increased by 47% over 2016, which was just remarkable. And I think you've seen new nonprofits cropping up. You've seen people, you know, coming out onto the streets and really vocalizing how, you know, concerned they are about our democracy. So I think on that side of it, things are getting a lot better. So I would give us a C minus, but there is a whole lot to be concerned about. And lastly, just, you know, it's obvious to everyone here, social cohesion of this country, the sense of belonging, the sort of deep political polarization, and the it really being very clear now that our institutions, and especially our democratic institutions, may not be suited to the kinds of challenges that we're dealing with right now, and that we really do have to look at fundamental systemic reform across the board.
So Minh-Thu, thank you so much for that. I'm going to start with addressing kind of my first more specific question to you. Pew did polls last year which showed that consistently about 30% of the American population believes that the 2020 election was stolen, and much higher percentages of Republicans believe that it was stolen, perhaps as much as 70%. What are some of the fundamental causes underlying this C-minus performance of the American democracy at this moment? How much of it do you think has to do, I guess I'd be interested in two things. One, you talk about the decline of local newspapers, which is of local news coverage. The flip side of that is sort of the huge dominance of social media transmission of information. So one question would be, what do you think gives rise to this much skepticism or this much doubt about who won the election, when the vast majority of the independent reporting suggests that there is no reason to believe, none at all, that the election was stolen? And then the second thing is, how do you address those underlying kind of problems?
Yeah, great question. And these are not easy issues. I think, you know, we've seen over the last few years a lot of social division. And I think a lot of that is grounded in the economics. I think a lot of people feel like, you know, the world is going in a direction that they don't necessarily understand. And when you look at, I think it's easy to blame globalization. It's easy to blame deep inequality that's increasing. And I think a lot of people look across the landscape and they're working incredibly hard, and they see that they just can't make it through. And at the same time, you have rapid technological change that's not keeping pace with even just our own ability to understand the world and what's going on. And I think the sense of depolarization, not understanding what's happening, seeing that you're working so hard and maybe not necessarily being able to make ends meet, I think the sense of fear and despair oftentimes will get people to believe in conspiracy theories, that there's some greater forces out there that they don't understand that's sort of controlling their lives. And when they see that there may be rampant corruption or money in politics that's controlling things, or, you know, their own ability to have agency in their own lives has been undermined by some other factors out there that they don't understand, I think it often makes people more susceptible to authoritarians, but also to conspiracy theories. And so when somebody says that, you know, with a tiny ounce of truth that there is voter fraud or that there's something else that's out there causing you to not be able to have control over your lives, I think people do believe that. And disinformation, particularly because of the efficiency of social media and the sort of technology platforms that we have, has really fed into that. I don't think that social media is itself alone to blame. I think, you know, that is an exacerbating factor. Throughout history, we've always had, you know, rapid technological change that's then been followed by deep social crises. And so, you know, whether that's the printing press back then or social media now, I don't think that in and of itself is a cause, but I do think, you know, that human element to it, when people are susceptible to believing in conspiracy theories, and then you have these pathways or these dissemination mechanisms that make it so much easier for us to believe it, but then also be so siloed in the kinds of information we get. I think, you know, you have what you see right now. How do we deal with it? I think, you know, social inclusion and belonging is a really deep need in any democracy, but in particular in a diverse, multiracial, multi-ethnic democracy. And this, you know, it's our democracy is an experiment. I mean, we're the most diverse country in the world, and we've got to figure out how to both create a sense of national identity while also honoring the differences and what makes each of our communities, each of our families really special here. It's a really tough challenge. I don't know that any country has been able to deal with that. Like Ashley, I've worked in other countries. I come from a foreign policy background. I decided to leave because I saw this crisis in our democracy. My family came here as refugees from Vietnam because they fundamentally believed that America was the beacon on the hill, you know, for democracy and freedom and security in the world. And then to see that, you know, start to fray really worried me quite a bit. I know that's the case for everyone on this panel and hopefully everyone in this room. You know, there is this sense out there. And so I think we need to do everything we can, but it is a human problem at its core, and we need to really address that.
So Art, if I may turn to you, how do you deal with what is often called the big lie? How do you combat disinformation, misinformation, malinformation? And in particular, I'd be interested in your thoughts on how you do that with a point that, you know, with immigrant populations who may be consuming media in their own native languages rather than English. Anyway, how do you get to an agreed set, a common set of facts?
I mean, definitely has not been easy. Our organization has been active on that the last few years when you think about disinformation, misinformation, but also malinformation. And especially when you think of the Spanish language and the different Latin American countries, there's terms that are used differently between different countries. And we've seen terms being used to deceive other folks from home countries as well. That's malinformation, of course. But the going back to the roots of that is looking at our membership and our members here in DC and in the country who are voting. When we think about access to voting in itself, access to a ballot, we don't have an official language, but de facto English is the language. And when you think of immigrant populations that may not be fully versed in English, you know, just the simple ask of, hey, can you give me this information in my native language, in my native tongue? We call that language justice, which we're fighting for, to make sure that ballots are in their language so they can participate in this democracy, if you want to call it, in the U.S. And we've seen, even in New York, where they changed their system to ranked choice voting, they had very little to no training on how to vote on their ballot with ranked choice voting. So we had many folks that reached out to us and told us, hey, my ballot was tossed out because I circled too many boxes. That's another point that we have to look into. Are we actually training our voting population on how to fill out that ballot? When you change the whole system like that, of course, but back to your question, definitely using the terminology, the words, when you think about Hispanic media, most of our families rely on specific anchors that they rely on each day or on the radio. You know, they listen to what they say with the 100%, they believe accuracy. We know now that it's not entirely accurate.
So what do you guys do to try to combat that? I mean, do you have people who truth squad, particular newscasts and try to post corrections or,
Yeah, since we are a membership organization, we host local town halls and clinics where we help train and teach the local populace on this. This is what you heard. This is actually, in actuality, what they meant and what they are lying about. The myths, demystifying what they're saying, or unpacking what they're saying too. This is what they said. What they actually meant was this, and the reality is this. Mm-hmm. But really, you have to go down to speaking to people face to face. You know, with Zoom and the pandemic, it was definitely hard. But going back to in person, having the in person interactions, you can do that. You can immediately tackle back and attack back with the information that we're fed. Day to day. And many of those folks that we've relied on for news, are now making their way into Congress. So many of them are now in Congress too, that folks that we've trusted now, our families are not able to fully trust them anymore.
Ashley, I'd like to widen the aperture slightly and talk a little bit about the importance of American democracy in the world. A friend of mine who is from the South Pacific island of Fiji was in D.C. a couple of weeks ago, and he had some free time, and he went to the memorials, and he talked about how at the Lincoln Memorial, reading Lincoln's second inaugural, he was sort of staggered at the thought that this is an experiment, the very beginning of the Constitution, in order to form a more perfect union. There's no belief that American democracy was then perfect or is now. And I'm interested in the extent to which you think the corrosion of democratic norms in this country may have a knock-on effect elsewhere. Does it matter what happens here for what happens in China, in Russia, in Hungary, or not? Or are those very local issues?
Yeah. It's funny. I do think that this point about us being an experiment remains a really salient one, because we are unusual. We are an unusual country. The premise of our existence was unusual at the time, and as Minh-Thu said, we remain unusual because we are this multiracial, multicultural, multireligious society that remains aspiring and remains a democracy, and that's unusual. And that is why it's important that we remain so in the eyes of the world, I believe as well, because there are lots of other multi-ethnic, multi-religious, pluralistic nations that that look to us. The global kind of democracy consensus has been on decline around the world for like over 15 years. So we are in good company when it comes to a broader trend that has been ongoing, as we've seen the rise of populist leaders in Brazil and in Hungary and India, really preying on some of these things that Minh-Thu talked about. Inequality, polarization, this kinds of populism, it tends to happen in quite polarized countries, and we are a quite polarized country. So we make ourselves vulnerable to that, to the rise of those kinds of leaders. I don't think we're leading the world in terms of this broader decline. I think we're experiencing it in tandem with many other democracies. But the fact that we are so visibly struggling. I mean, we have the spotlight on us, certainly after January 6th, does really matter. There are norms breaking down right and left, even when it comes to the norm around international election observation, for example. So being able to send observers, international election observers, to other countries and sort of hold them up to certain kinds of democratic standards. Countries are pushing back on those kinds of norms now. There's the sort of leadership role that we play, even when Biden had his Democracy Summit big foreign policy event last December. You know, lots of questions about our ability, our credibility, even to hold such a global agenda-setting event, because we sort of hadn't gotten our own house in order, so to speak. And so, I do think it really matters. The problem is these are things that can't be undone. You know, very very quickly. We can't sort of once the kind of reputation and the norm has been eroded, it's really hard to build it back. Mm-hmm. I think our credibility has been bruised, and so we really do have to work hard domestically and overseas to demonstrate our commitment to human rights, to democratic values and freedoms, and we have to do it in a consistent way. But I think that people are yearning for that. I think democracies are yearning for that. People seeking who are not in democratic societies that are seeking freedom yearn for us to play that role, and I don't think we should cede it just because we do have these problems at home. I think we have to, you know, walk and chew gum at the same time and do both.
Minh-Thu, one quick question to you before we go to questions both virtually and from the audience. Do you sort of agree with the premise of what Ashley was saying, that when the United States sneezes, the rest of the world catches a cold? And what can be done to, one of the beauties of the design of this society was the division, you know, the separation of powers. Which is one of our most fundamental sort of guardrails, right? Because power is not vested in any one branch, let alone any one individual. That said, what can be done to strengthen the guardrails of democracy so that when norms are violated, there is a tendency toward bringing them back?
Yeah, thanks for that. And you know, I 100% agree with Ashley. I'm not sure that the US sneezes and everyone catches and that we're leading this. I think she's right that we are part of a global trend. And I think one of the reasons for that global trend is that, you know, the premise of your previous question, we are an experiment. And the second that any of us takes our foot off of the pedal, in terms of paying attention to the norms, the institutions, the ideas of our democracy, that's when things start to fall apart. And I think, you know, us being able to, pay attention to the fissures in our society, not just in terms of social divisions, but the economic divisions is really important. There are countries out there that are offering a different model. You look at China and they believe that they are a democracy, and they will say that our model is really messy. Democracy, you know, in America, if you wanted to look around the world and say that you wanted to follow that, I think the Chinese would point to us and say, look at how messy it is. You know, it's they can't even get their COVID policies, you know, straight. People are arguing over vaccinations and masks. There's, you know, gun violence. I mean, the horrors of this past week. But, you know, so I think there are other countries, other models that are out there, and people are looking around the world to say, well, what should we follow? But the American model, I think we have to show that this experiment works, because even though democracy is messy, the fact of the matter is it has to be messy. If you're talking about a multicultural, multiracial, diverse society, and our societies, it's not just American, but, you know, other societies are also getting more and more diverse. So the more that we can pay attention to the needs of folks, how do we bring people in? How do we create this sense of belonging? Art raised a really important point about Spanish language political outreach. Within the Asian American community, you know, there are a lot of people who don't feel like they belong in our democracy, immigrants, the poor, people of color. But when you reach out to them, they actually do turn out to vote. If there's a way to sort of broaden our sense of who belongs as a citizen, who has a say in our democracy, that is a critical part of the solution. I think a lot of people are saying right now that corruption of democracies around the world, not just in the US, but in Europe and in other parts, that's one of the causes of this. And I think a lot of people will look at American democracy and say that money in politics has corrupted our democracy such that it's made it really hard for us to be able to make basic decisions about how we govern ourselves. And so, you know, one potential solution is, as I mentioned, first is just creating that broader sense of belonging. And then second, how do we figure out who really has a say in our democracy, who votes and who pays for these elections, and who do our political leaders listen to and why? I think there's a fundamental challenge of how do we democratize campaign finance? How do we democratize voting and political outreach? How do we include more people in this experiment so that they feel like they can actually participate in this? One of the takeaways from this, I hope that we don't have, is that, you know, there's everything is just is, you know, we should all be in despair and things are hopeless. I actually think there is a glimmer of hope. And I hope that, you know, people will step up and say, you know, we can do something about this and let's try to bring in more people.
Thank you. At this time, I'd like to invite participants to join our conversation with their questions. A reminder that this meeting is on the record. We'll start with a question from our virtual audience. If the CFR staff would kindly recognize somebody from Zoom.
We'll take the first question from Galila Yonas.
Hi, thank you so much for speaking with us today. I'm Galila Yonas. I'm a junior studying IR in public health at the College of William and Mary. And I was studying how the dramatic instances of global blackfighting in recent years has also been adjacent to the increase in accessible technology in both journalism media and social media. And you guys touched on this earlier, but I was wondering how you all feel we should address the power of social media, given that the pillar of freedom to organize and freedom of speech has emboldened specifically alt-right groups with liberal sentiments, especially because there are just so many forums indoctrinating the young population.
Ashley, you want to take a shot at that?
Sure. Well, I am
an easy one.
Exactly. I was going to say I can't offer any deeply knowledgeable answer, but I do think that Europe and the EU has done much more than we have done to think about how we engage productively with, you know, government oversight of social media platforms, and the U.S. really needs to follow suit and to find, you know, whatever regulatory framework we are going to use. The platforms say that they're asking for this, and we just haven't been able to get on board with doing something about it. So it's a really important, the social media companies largely originate in our country and they have outsized influence on what's happening all over the world. And so it's incumbent upon us, I think, not only for ourselves, but for all of the ways in which social media is influencing events, which we know it is in Burma and other places for bad and maybe for good in other places. But but there are models, I would say, to draw from, especially out of Europe, that we should look towards.
Do we have a question from this gentleman in the far back?
Thank you. Hello, my name is Kendrick Roberson. I am a professor of political science over at Pepperdine University in Malibu, California. And my question revolves around the Senate, which by constitutional design is an anti-democratic institution to the extent that I live in California. If there's someone in North Carolina, their vote is worth 9 times as much as mine in the Senate. Right, and if I move to North Carolina, then my vote becomes 9 times more than my mom's. Right, if I move to D.C., then my vote in the Senate is actually zero. My representation in the Senate is zero, right? Because they are denied Senate representation, even though they have a larger population than 2 other states, right? And so my question to you all is, what do we think about this? You know, I guess there's a small, tiny movement out there that says abolish the Senate, but there's no traction to that. Because we kind of play into the Senate role because it exists, and if we don't play into it, then we lose major gains. And so I just wanted to know your thoughts on the Senate as we have this democracy conversation.
Thank you for that. Art, as a fellow or at least former Californian, I'd be interested in your thoughts about that. I'm reminded of the old saying that the hot tea of the House is cooled in the saucer of the Senate. But tell me what you think about that.
I don't drink tea, but I'll believe you. No, I mean, abolish the Senate. I've heard repeal and replace the Senate. You know, maybe it's time for us to evaluate, you know, parliamentary, you know, government here for us. When you think about the population representation, you know, California, we didn't, our population didn't grow enough, so we actually lost a seat in the House. How does that make sense? Our population did not grow enough, but other states who grew at a lesser rate got an extra seat in the House. Mm-hmm. When you think about, you know, our residents and citizens that are living in territories, you know, Puerto Rico has over 2.3 million population-wise, and they don't have any voice in government. They have a non-voting member in the House as a delegate, as a resident commissioner, but, you know, they have a population that's more than almost 20th of the least populated states in the U.S. when you think about representation. Professor, good question. But yeah, I mean, that's exactly, what's next? What do we do about that? Yeah.
Can please. I just jump in? Yeah. You know, one, there's a very interesting report that I recommend to you from the Academy of Arts and Sciences called Our Common Purpose. It was done a couple of years ago. It makes a number, it makes 31 recommendations sort of to think about how we reimagine American democracy. And one of those recommendations is about expanding the House of Representatives to sort of, you know, there, it's been 438 for however long, and our country has continued to grow. It recommends things like looking at multi-member districts, you know, thinking about having multiple people who could represent a single constituency. It's a lot of innovative ideas there that I think, you know, trying to put out, you know, thought leadership about how we could reimagine American democracy if we wanted to make it more representative. So I think you might want to look at that report. It has some very interesting recommendations.
I think Mitch McConnell might have some things to say about your thoughts on Abbas and Chuck Schumer. I think we, actually, forgive me, we're going to go to the virtual question, please.
We'll take the next question from Earl Carr.
Good afternoon, Earl Carr, founder and CEO of CJPA Global Advisors. I'm curious to know your thoughts on U.S. democracy, particularly in international institutions like the United Nations. How should we think about democracy, particularly as it relates to enlarging the UN Security Council? Biden made a number of interesting statements looking at including Japan as a permanent Security Council member at the UN. Curious to get your thoughts on that. Thank you so much.
Minh-Thu, do you want to take a shot at that one? As you all obviously know, there are five permanent members of the UN Security Council, and those were decided right after the Second World War. So is it still relevant to have those five nations represented? Please.
Thanks so much for that great question, Earl. You know, as Arshad said, you know, the UN was founded after World War II. It is built into the UN Charter that those are the five countries that have the veto. Whether we expand the Security Council or not, you know, this has been a debate that's been ongoing almost since the beginning of the UN. So, you know, it's probably even tougher than this question of expanding or getting rid of the Senate, right? So there are procedural issues there. I think, though, you know, more recently, given what's going on in Ukraine and President Zelensky really putting that challenge to the world about what's the relevance of the UN if it can't prevent a fundamental, you know, a breach of its own charter where one country unprovoked goes and invades another country. I think that is a challenge for the world. We are seeing a crisis in multilateralism and how we come together as a world to defend democracy. But let me just say that, you know, one glimmer of hope here is that when the UN General Assembly had to vote to condemn Russia, 141 countries came out, and these were not just Western countries. I do have a bee in my bonnet about us continually calling it, you know, the West against Russia. It isn't the West. There were many countries that came out at great risk to themselves and their diplomacy to condemn the Russian invasion of Ukraine. But that was a shining light, and the Russians were kicked out of the UN Human Rights Council as well. So there are ways around this. And I think this is a lesson for us in how do we organize and work with other people to be able to rally around concepts of democracy and threats to democracy to be able to prevent it. It can be done. It's hard. There are challenges to the UN. There are challenges to global democracy. But when we actually you know, put pedal to the metal and really try to reach out to our colleagues and other people, you can actually send the right signals to support democracy.
Thank you. I think there was a lady in the black there. Yep.
Hello, my name is Taryn Scott. I am an intern for the U.S. Senate. So my question to you all is, so my train of thought basically is that we're seeing like hyper-partisanship within our political systems. And I think a symptom of this is an acceleration of independent voters. So in what way do you think that diversity is beneficial within political parties and perhaps a potential drawback?
Art, would you like to take that one?
Yeah, definitely. Not only diversity in how we look, but also diversity in thought. And we acknowledge that as well. Right now, it's too much diversity in thought, if I can say that. But yeah, I mean, the Senate has changed the rules in its history, and they're able to do it again. You know, they've, you know, we know that you need at least 60 votes to get much done, but they've changed the rules to have a majority, simple majority vote. And they can do that. And we ask ourselves, why don't they do that? You know, they always, what do they call it, the point of no return, but when they have a term for this.
Yeah, the nuclear option.
Nuclear option, yeah. There you go. I try to not use that word, but that's the word that we've seen done in the past, where, you know, even when we think about, you know, how the last government was able to appoint 3 Supreme Court justices who are definitely changing the dynamics of our country, and we're seeing the repercussions of that now to this day. But that's a very good question. They have the capacity to do that. Why don't they? We ask ourselves each day. Even if it's simple legislation that the House of Representatives passed, you know, there's legislation that has been waiting for over a year for the Senate to even act on that. Just this morning, LULAC, where we sent a letter to the Senate to ask them to pass the Bipartisan Background Check Act, but also to think about how they're going to react to gun violence prevention. We're asking them to raise the age to 21 to be able to purchase any firearms. We already have rules that you have to be 21 to buy tobacco, alcohol. Why are those being treated differently than firearms? So, yeah.
Can I just another
question? Yeah, please. Sorry, who was speaking?
It was Minh-Thu.
Minh-Thu, yes, by all means.
I wanted to just add another quick point to that. You were talking about communities of color. What's interesting is that Latino and Asian American communities actually by and large register as independents in this country. And so, you know, I think sometimes we take diversity for granted and a lot of people assume that communities of color are just gonna vote for one party. But in fact, a lot of communities of color, in particular first generation Americans who are new voters, don't already have party allegiance or allegiance to any particular party. And so they do often end up voting independent, which means that they're often disenfranchised because the primary elections and the vast majority of elections in this country are determinative because our districts are already gonna be red or blue. And so the primary is really where your representation matters. But if you're a registered independent, most of the time you're not able to vote. So that is an issue. And I thought that was just a really good question and I wanted to highlight that issue.
Thank you. Shall we take another question from let's go. We'll move around the room. The lady in the front, please.
Hi, good afternoon. And my name is Valerie Leon Quintero, and I'm representing Wheaton College, Massachusetts. And my question is oriented on the future of democracy concerning Puerto Rico and Hawaii, given that, as we talked, that we need to demonstrate commitment in human rights and how we defend all of these issues. And we often forget about these territories that we can also call colonies, given that they are second-class citizens perceived by the government. So how can we demonstrate our commitment to human rights, and how can we move forward in a democracy where those voices are included and they are used not part of any economic benefit for the United States? Thank you.
Ashley, do you have any thoughts on that?
I was looking at you, Art.
Art, go ahead, Art.
I was going to say again, LULAC, we are a membership-based organization, and when you think about our most heavily involved states, Texas, California, Puerto Rico, and then New York. So we have our membership in Puerto Rico that is very active. They've seen the way they've been treated, for decades as a territory. You know, they've been talking about self-determination for the last, 2-3 decades, and we're still talking about that to this day. LULAC as an organization, we've come out in support of our Puerto Ricans for full statehood. They voted at least three times for statehood to be a part of this democracy, if you want to call it that, here in the U.S. They are citizens of the U.S., but they're not being treated as citizens, second-class citizens. You know, they're not able to vote for the president. They have no representation in Congress, in the House, or in the Senate. That's definitely something that we need to consider as we think about what it means to, when you talk about the health of our democracy, the heart of our democracy, when you exclude people, not only because of how they look, but where they live. You know, Puerto Ricans can come to the mainland and they'll have the full rights and benefits, but why is it any different from where they live?
Speaking as somebody who was born and mostly raised in Washington, D.C., and who still lives there now, I feel a certain sympathy for this. I could move to Maryland or Virginia, but I'm loyal. Let's stay in the room unless there are some more questions. So there's a gentleman wearing a jacket in the second row. Yes.
Thank you for the selection. I'm Hakim. I'm a fellow at the Elliott School of International Affairs. I will ask a simple question, which is twofold. One, I would be interested in the panelists' view on what is the most pressing foreign policy problem right now the United States facing, and what's your comment on any of the solutions? And the second fold would be the previous question that was proposed in terms of how do you strengthen the institutions, the check and balances, so that can help implement better policies and the role of citizenry. Thank you.
Who would like to take that one? Minh-Thu, would you?
Maybe I'll just go first. If it's okay, I'll say there are two main challenges. One is climate change, or you said most pressing foreign policy challenge. I think the first is climate change and second is democracy. And I wouldn't put one above the other. I think you have to have a vibrant democracy to be able to really tackle some of the climate change problems that we need to address. And that obviously if we don't tackle climate, we're not gonna have democracies to enjoy in the future. These are really, really important.
Ashley.
I would just say, I think the answer to that question really depends on who you're talking to. And
I'm talking to you.
Well, I know, but what do I think are the most important foreign policy challenges? I agree, it's certainly with climate, even though it's not an issue I work on. I think it's an enormously important issue. I think that we are going into a world of heightened geopolitical conflict, not necessarily like hot conflict, but certainly cold conflict with China, whether we recognize it or not, because that conflict is taking on economic dimensions and cyber dimensions and other kinds of dimensions. And I think that is going to determine a lot of our foreign policy going forward and our economic policy going forward. And so I think that's a big challenge. And I think that is reflected in why President Biden decided to go to the region just this past week. The second question was about how do we strengthen institutions to be more effective? I think that there's a lot of good ideas around institutional reform, certainly, for example, out of the Our Common Purpose report. I think, though, that where I see the most optimism is at the state or local level. I think these are really right now where we find the greatest laboratories for democracy, both because of what we're seeing in terms of citizen engagement and mobilization. I mean, look at Georgia. They just mobilized more voters than they had in 2020 for a primary election. It was really an amazing civil society mobilization. And I think that institutional reform, there's also great power coming from the people. Michigan just had a very successful redistricting movement where they successfully got a nonpartisan commission put in place, and they're going to have for the first time very competitive districts in a number of places, which is really going to matter there. So I think, but that's all coming from the grassroots. It's all coming from citizens. So I think it's bottom up. I think it's highly localized, state based. I think that's where the action and energy is.
Our top two global problems, and how do we strengthen the institutions?
No, I mean, we definitely, we pulled our members on issues and we asked them, and the top two were environmental justice, of course, and climate change as two different issues. When you think about our reliance, as our technology advances, our reliance on foreign countries for those rare earth elements that we need for our devices, you know, they're not being reproduced, so we have to recycle those. And knowing where those are going to, when we think about renewable energy, electric vehicles, you know, how much of our population is able to afford those new electric vehicles, you know, to rely on transportation. But the role that the government is doing to make sure that it's affordable for folks to use that transportation. So, yeah.
Thank you. Yes, the lady wearing red in, I think, the third row, please.
Hi, thank you so much. My name is Olivia Issa. I take she, her pronouns. I work in refugee resettlement. My question is about gun violence and gun control. I've seen studies recently that show that the vast majority of people in the US, even up to 90% from some studies, are in favor of more stringent gun control or gun laws. And I'm curious, with all the inaction, I'm happy to hear that some of you have been involved in legislation recently, but this is a decades-long problem, and there's been, you know, massive inaction in Congress. I'm curious, from each of your experiences, what this has done to represent American democracy in the international sphere. Thank you.
Art, you want to take that one, since I know that's an issue you worked.
Yeah, an issue that we're working on this week. You know, just what 12 days ago, when Buffalo incident happened, we worked with our partners, the ADL and the National Urban League and NAACP. To write a letter to the White House urging them to hold a national conference on hate and domestic terrorism. And we got a phone call a few days later. They invited us to the White House to have a conversation and start planning that process so that we can have that dialogue and that conversation. And then now with gun violence prevention, as we see, when Sandy Hook happened, you know, that's when it became okay for us to ignore it. Unacceptable. You know, to this day, the events that happened in Uvalde, you know, the second deadliest shooting since Sandy Hook, you know, for us to hit close to home, about 90% of the population of that school, Hispanic origin. You know, again, I was saying we have a council there and members that have been working nonstop, helping the families, helping the neighborhoods try to recuperate over that. But there has to be action. And as I was saying earlier, we're pushing not only President Biden, but Congress to act now. And the least they can do is raise the age to make sure that guns are inaccessible. Those, in many of those incidences, the guns were purchased legally, you know, unfortunately. So.
Maybe just a quick two finger on that. I really hope that people don't lose hope. I know a lot of people are saying, if we didn't do anything after Sandy Hook, there's no way we're gonna be doing something now. I actually don't believe that at all, because the world has changed since then. Back then in 2012, 2013, when people tried to get through sensible gun safety legislation, the gun lobby was a lot more powerful. Right now and since then, the gun safety advocates, moms, you know, communities across the country have really come out. I mean, this is the value of civic engagement, right? They've really come out, and I think the environment has changed. Yes, Sandy Hook was an absolutely horrific thing. Just because we didn't do anything then doesn't mean that we're not going to do something now. I actually think that the momentum has changed. The gun lobby is weaker than it was then. I don't think we can give up hope. Maybe one thing to just leave everyone with, you know, when after Trump was elected, I know a lot of folks, even if, you know, and not as a partisan matter, but folks who were pro-democracy were pretty discouraged. And John, what's his name, from The Daily Show, John Stewart, he said, you know, Trump talks about making America great again. Maybe he will make America great again. And I actually think that has come to fruition. Americans from all walks of life are stepping up, are becoming much more civically engaged. And so I hope that you all do, because we absolutely need you to. If you're worried about climate change, if you're worried about our democracy, if you're worried about gun safety in schools, I think it just means that we all have to step up and do more to strengthen our democracy.
Thank you all for joining today's CDI plenary, and thank you very much to our panelists. It's a rare panel in Washington that ends on a note of hope, so thank you for that, Minh-Thu. Please note that the video and transcript of this symposium will be posted on CFR's website, and please join us for a virtual and in-person networking receptions via Zoom and here at the Council. Thank you.